Erik Shapiro is Associate Professor of Radiology and serves as Research Director of the Radiology Department. He also has courtesy appointments in physiology and chemical engineering and is a member of the neuroscience program and the comparative medicine and integrative biology program. Erik received his PhD in chemistry from the University of Pennsylvania in 2001 and did a postdoctoral fellowship at the National Institutes of Health, NIH, where he garnered a Fellows Award for Research Excellence in 2005. Erik was hired as an assistant professor at Yale University School of Medicine in 2006 in the departments of diagnostic radiology and biomedical engineering. The highlight of Erik's career at Yale was being awarded the NIH Director's New Innovator Award in 2008. It is the highest honor NIH awards junior investigators. Enticed by the opportunity to build an imaging enterprise and to help grow a biomedical engineering program, Erik was successfully recruited here to MSU in 2012.
Thank you for the introduction, and it's really wonderful to be here, and I appreciate the invitation to share some of the research going on in my laboratory. So the title here is Nanomaterials, Regenerative Medicine and Biomedical Imaging, Molecular and Cellular MRI at MSU. And as you can tell from the title, my research sits at the interface of nanomaterials, regenerative medicine, and biomedical imaging, or what is in a much broader scale, biomedical engineering. And so I want to tell a little bit about the research going on in my laboratory. Regenerative medicine is a new term for what has been called for a long time cell-based therapy. And so I just show a quick diagram here of what cell-based therapy might look like. In this example, we can take some adult skin cells. We can reprogram these adult skin cells to become stem cell-like cells. And once these cells achieve this stem cell-like property, called induced pluripotent stem cells, they can be redifferentiated into other tissues and then used therapeutically for treating all kinds of diseases like Parkinson's disease or muscle diseases or heart diseases. And so this is really revolutionary, the ability to use these cells for therapeutics. And so my laboratory comes in here, where we're interested in the transplantation of these cells and the clinical applicability of cell-based therapies. And so what aspects of stem cell therapy can we image? Well, we can image cell delivery, because we'd like to know what is the transplant outcome itself, the immediate transplant outcome of cell therapies. We can image cell migration. So after we've delivered cells, did they home correctly to the right spot, or did they home aberrantly to the wrong spot? We can image cell maturation. That is, sometimes we want to deliver immature cells and let them develop endogenously into adult cells. And so we're designing agents that will allow imaging to non-invasively detect this. And we're also looking at, aside from the cells, have we regenerated the tissue in mass that we're interested in? And so over the next couple hours, I'd like to discuss how images are formed. So we do this in two semesters, but I'll do it in 30 seconds. What you see here is an MRI of a brain and an MRI of a heart. And the contrast that we see in these images, our ability to pick out different tissues one from another, is because the water molecules in those tissues have different properties from the water molecules in other tissues. And most significant is that the magnetic properties of the water molecules differ. And so if I take some cell-based therapy and try to transplant it into a piece of tissue, the MRI doesn't see that cell therapy because the environment of the water in those cells is no different. So very serendipitously, we discovered that cells like to uptake magnetic particles. And so what we do is we label cells. What I'm showing you here are microscope slides of cells growing in culture with, if you can see, these little micromagnetic particles. Cells will take this in. We can change the magnetic property of those cells so that when we transplant them, we can detect them. And so as an example, what I show here, this is an MRI of a rat's brain, a live rat brain taken on our brand new 7-Tesla small animal MRI system, at the time one of only two in the entire country. And we can see here I've transplanted cells into this animal, and you don't see spots. You see brain, but you don't see spots. When I transplant cells that harbor these magnetic particles, you see spots. Each one of these spots is a single stem cell. We were the first to demonstrate that MRI can detect individual cells in an intact animal. And so we've used this for lots of interesting paradigms. What I show you here is this is our ability to track neural stem cell migration in an intact animal over, in this case, 7 days. And so this technology, very different from the ability to use CT, where you know we're limited by the serial applicability. MRI has no issues with serial imaging of subjects. Furthermore, we have a major interest in the biomedical nanomaterials that are required for not only in the research purposes, but advancing this towards clinical applicability. So my laboratory has really pioneered the development of clinically viable bio-nanomaterials using some very simple chemical engineering technologies, where we can make magnetic nanoparticles. These are about 100 nanometers in diameter. We can make magnetic microparticles that are a micron in diameter. And as part of an MSU Foundation grant that we recently received, we've established a program, in essence, of chemically engineered nanomaterials for translational biomedical imaging. And this broad platform is developing nanomaterials for MRI, nanomaterials that are X-ray dense that will allow serial CT imaging for really exciting emerging CT technologies, and imaging-enabled vaccines, brand new platforms for designing cancer vaccines. Now, for a long time, I don't know how many years, but for a long time we've been using rodents as the real workhorse for biomedical sciences. But there's emerging strength in large animal models for disease. Indeed, in 2012, there was a symposium held at NIH which basically said imaging is essential for developing and monitoring therapy, but really pushing the idea that large animal models are critical for progressing regenerative medicine and cancer. Pigs are likely to play a leading role, and pig stem cells are a valuable resource. And Science Translational Medicine, one of the premier journals for translational medicine, you can see has highlighted the use of the mini pig as a biomedical tool. And so we've tried to hit this in stride, working together with researchers at the USDA and having now submitted a grant in collaboration with the University of Pittsburgh and the University of Missouri. We are moving forward with pig stem cell-derived hepatocytes for liver transplantation, with the goal of these pig-derived cells may actually have potential for human liver disease treatment. It's extremely exciting. It's very forward-thinking. It's very controversial at the same time. But the idea of xenotransplantation has an interesting history, particularly with islet cells. And we're hoping for hepatocytes as well. So in summary, my laboratory has designed MRI experiments for visualizing regenerative medicine paradigms. We are fully into developing and optimizing nanomaterials for clinical utility and for monitoring cell maturation. And we're actively moving towards large animal models of disease. And so President Simon, I've taken your challenge of thinking boldly to heart. And so I want to have a statement that I hope is something that's energizing, is that I think MSU has the unique opportunity to be a world leader in large animal models of disease and regenerative medicine by integrating this enormously powerful and rich animal science and biotechnology infrastructure we have here on campus with the emerging biomedical and genetic engineering. If we can put these two together, it would be transformative for science and for the university. And so I'm hoping to play a leading role in this.
Here.
Oh, thank you. I have wonderful collaborators here at Michigan State University. I've assembled a really dynamic, interesting laboratory. We've been quite lucky for having sustained grant funding for the last 10 years or so. And I want to really thank you and Professor Hsu for inviting me to speak and for all of you listening. And I'm happy to answer questions if you have some. So thank you.
I don't know where to start asking you questions about your presentation. So I want to ask a question I understand. How did we get fortunate enough to get you here?
You bought me an MRI machine. So I'm from New Jersey, right? And I was just saying, I'm from New Jersey. And when I was telling people back home, I said they made me an offer I couldn't refuse. And they all understood what that meant.
But beyond the gadget, what attracted you here?
So I am overly excited about the upward trajectory of biomedical research here on campus. So when I arrived, Dr. Shu had just arrived, there's now 6 new chairs of biomedical departments. This institution is on its way sharply up in biomedical research. And the development of this biomedical engineering department and this bioengineering institute, I really want to play a leading role in this. And I want to grow this infrastructure on campus. And I want to continue that upward trajectory at Michigan State University. It was a unique opportunity to be part of something like that, and I wasn't going to let it go. Thank you.
I think this is a, Steve can comment, this is a good example of taking some pieces that, the analogy I use about being bold is finding some new pieces, but it's also taking pieces that you have, if you grow up with one of those kaleidoscope things, and trying to move them into different kinds of positioning. So that you begin with an asset base that is not from scratch, because many people build this from scratch. And one of our, I think, great strengths is the capacity to take and move pieces around, then add some new pieces along the way to really propel us at a much faster rate, and also to take if the conversation we had about boldly over the last 2 or 3 years, sort of what's the next equivalent of the big idea? What's in the code words? What's the next equivalent of EFRIP? But EFRIP started with pieces we already had. We didn't sort of do it from whole cloth. And so this is part of that big vision about where science is going and how we can accelerate not only through that curve of change, but we can accelerate around others because of our capacity to put pieces together and add a couple more in the work along the way and get people, you don't know the names on that list, but they come from lots of places across campus, which I think was one of the other things as we tried to recruit you. We told you that you would have access more broadly across campus than what would be traditionally defined at a medical school.
No, the opportunity to, I mean, I liken this to someone took a beautiful giant Lego set and went pew, like this with it. And there are pieces everywhere through campus, and it's just remarkable. And so I'm trying, you know, we're assembling these beautiful Lego pieces and building a beautiful castle in some sense. And we're thankful for the opportunity. Yeah.
Thank you for being here. Steve, do you want to end with it?
Those of you who are college football fans know that signing day just passed, and you can look up the rankings of various schools and how they did with their recruiting class. And we have to do the same thing in research science. Erik is part of our all-star class of 2012. We have very high hopes for that class, but I think the class of 2015 will be even better.
Thank you, Erik.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you for your work.